also defined like a democratic society. So it is by IDOS, for IDOS, and to IDOS. So all the participants in this webinar are members of our Indore Division of Ophthalmological Society, the speakers, the panelists, and the moderators. Everybody is of IDOS. So welcome you all, and I invite Dr. O.P. Agarwal, our president, to start give some inaugural comments for this webinar. Over to you, Dr. O.P. Agarwal.
Thank you, Amit. Good evening, everybody. At the outset, I thank Ajanta for giving the platform to start. IDOS is organizing lot many webinars and clinical meetings. Due to this COVID era, in last 1.5 years, it was a very small number of clinical meetings and conferences which it was not possible to organize. I welcome all delegates to attend this case-based discussion on mucormycosis. I thank and invite all the panelists, moderators, and speakers to attend this webinar. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Opie, sir. So without wasting much of time, I hand over this podium to our two moderators, the scientific committee members, Dr. Sumit Agarwal and Dr. Manushri Sharma. So these two are the moderators for this webinar. And from here onwards, these two people will take over the webinar and they'll moderate the whole session. So over to you, Dr. Sumit. I think we should start the webinar without wasting any time. Sumit, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good evening all. Welcome to this very unique webinar on mucormycosis. I hope I'm audible to everyone.
Yes, Sumit, you're audible.
So this will be a purely case-based discussion. And we have six speakers with us today who will be presenting multiple interesting cases. And this will be followed by a discussion. So there will be 8 minutes allotted for the case presentation, followed by 8 minutes of discussion by our very experienced and eminent panel. So without further much ado, I would like to invite our first presenter, Dr. Animesh Sahu, sir. Sir is a senior consultant, oculoplasty, orbit and cataract services at Retina Specialty Eye Hospital. Over to you, sir. Please start with your presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Sumit. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
I'm just to start sharing my screen. So, good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank IDOS for giving me the opportunity to share my experience in the cases of rhino-orbital mucormycosis. So not wasting much of time, I start my presentation. Like said, the one size does not fit for the all. So the same thing I found with the cases of mucormycosis. In the mucormycosis, there is no definite and permanent treatment till now available. So whenever we start treatment for one patient, it's not necessary that the treatment is the same for the other patient, which is having the almost same kind of condition. So we should have a tailored approach. Like each and every patient, we should give a different kind of thoughts. So starting with the first case, this is a male presented to us with the 17th day of the COVID positive test. His primary complaint was the vision loss. He has a history of using IV dexa while the treatment of the COVID. On examination, the eye was not having the PL in the right eye. In fundus, there is central retinal artery occlusion. And also the partial ptosis and partial ophthalmic plasia was there. With the suspicion in the mind of he is developing the orbital mucormycosis. I go for immediately contrast MRI and also refer the patient to the ENT colleague for the evaluation. In the MRI, there is medial orbital involvement was there. Being an ophthalmologist, I observed that. And also the sinus involvement was there. The ENT surgeon performed the sinus debridement, followed by a patient came to me. Looking at the involvement of the orbit, I decided to give the trial of injection retrobulbar amphotericin. I have given 3 injections on an alternate day basis. And the result I found was surprising to me because he has improving in lactosis as well as the ophthalmoplegia, as well as the ocular involvement. So while this case, I would like to highlight to the parent that injection train or retrobulbar amputation may be worked here, but it's not true for the all cases because I have given injection more than 10 patients, but the improvement I found in this one only case. One or two more cases are there in the lineup. Those are having the minimal improvement. So till now the train is not a proven treatment, but it is a good option for the patient. Those are having good vision with minimal orbital involvement or only the apex is involved. The important thing in this kind of patient, we should see the MRI and show the viability of the tissue. If it is taking contrast, the tissue is viable, the necrosis is not so much. So you can start a trial of retrobulbar amphotericin. It can be work as a step-by procedure in the young patient where there is difficult to advise the patient directly for the eccentration. Many times they refuse. And many a times they have a fear of eccentration. So while the time they are not ready for the eccentration, at least we can limit the disease by using the retroorbital amphotericin. For me till now, there is no PLI with the ophthalmoplegia, whether it is complete or partial is not an indication for the eccentration. I think we will discuss the, we will take the question after the finishing the case presentation. So this is the second case. It is an interesting case. The young patient with a history of IV dexa 6 days and remdesivir for 5 days. He is admitted in a multi-specialty hospital. He came 11 days after the COVID with a complaint of nasal blood discharge. The diagnosis was made, rhino-orbital mucormycosis. Patient underwent the primary surgery by the ENT surgeon in the form of sinus debridement. When I was called for the reviewing the patient, I found the left eye is no PL. And the complaint ophthalmoplegia was there. On the MRI, there is diffuse sinuses involvement was there. And the diffuse orbit is involved. The important thing in this patient, when I observed the brain, there is focal frontal lobe abscess was there. So it's recent degrading system, it comes under the grade of 4C into the IGO. So it is a kind of team approach we applied in this patient. The team of neurosurgeon, oculoplastic surgeon, and the ENT surgeon. In the same sitting, the neurosurgeon performed the frontal lobe abscess drainage, which was the USG guided. I performed the orbital examination and clear all the margins. And the ENT surgeon performed the amputation wash as well as a little bit of debridement. Till now, the last follow-up, I think it's around 22 days or there. Patient is alive with the regression of the disease shown in the MRI picture. So the highlighting point in this patient was the brain involvement may not be the always grave, the requirement of the timely intervention. And in this type of patient, the multidisciplinary approach is a key for the successful treatment. Examination is indicated when there were extensive orbital involvement, but there are not extensive brain involvement. In this type of patient, neurologist opinion, patient physical status is very important to make a decision. This is the third case, which are COVID history, obviously, and using DEXA and remdesivir during the treatment. He presented only 5th day of the COVID with a symptom of nasal stuffiness and a nasal discharge. By ENT surgeon, it has undergone the sinus debridement. And when I went to the bedside examination for the patient, the right eye was not having the PL and complete ophthalmoplegia was there. On bedside vision was, left eye vision was counting more than 2 feet. But further follow up when he came to our clinic or hospital, I found the vision was 624 and the partial ophthalmoplegia was there in that left eye. In the MRI picture, there were diffuse bilateral sinus involvement was there. and the, as well as the orbital involvement, which is right eye is more than the left eye. Also find the intraocular extension in the form of fungal cellulitis, sphenoid wing erosion, and fissure soft tissue inflammation. It's come under the grade of 4C, the recent classification. So it is also a required a teamwork of ENT surgeon, neurologist, as well as me. After discussion with the neurologist, he advised the patient we can plan for the orbital excentration because the disease is already progressed much, but the patient denied. He don't want for the excentration. So till now he want to think, the time being, he started giving trial of the retroverbal amphotericin B. There is other factor also there because of the availability of the systemic treatment was not complete at that time. Hardly he is getting injection, one or two injection in a day. Still the patient is alive and he is stable in the condition. The key point in this patient is the patient choice may not be in his best interest sometime, but their decision has to be respected because the exudation is a very radical surgery. It has a huge psychological impact over the patient. And it's very difficult for the patient sometimes to accept as a primary option of the treatment. And the orbital excentration post-surgery, the rehabilitation with the processes is very important part of the treatment. It's not only the excentration we perform in orbit. This is the one of my first few cases I got around, I think this patient I operated 3 months ago. The having of history of positive in the corona. And while looking at the clinical condition, it was a clear-cut case of fungal mucormycosis. While searching for the history, I found there's comorbidity associated with it, like diabetic ketoacidosis was there, and patient also having history of renal transplant. On examination, the eye is no PN, complete ophthalmoplegia, SCR were there in the lid, and the ACS full of hyphenol. There is diffuse sinus involvement was there. And while looking at the MRI imaging, I found there is a gross difference between the MRI picture and the clinical picture. If you see how the MRI, the orbit involvement is not so much. Anyway, with the discussion of the neurologist and ENT surgeon, we performed the excentration surgery for giving the best chance of his survival. The surgery has gone well, but because of the multi-organ failure, he survived well up to 2 months, and best of all of it, he died 2 months after the surgery. So the highlighting point in this patient, I would like to emphasize that many times in the mucormycosis, especially the clinical picture and the imaging findings are not going with the hand-to-hand with like many other cases of oculoplasty. The survival determination is dependent upon the reversibility of the underlying risk factor, the time of initiation of the IV amphotericin B.
I'm sorry to interrupt, sir, but we are running out of time for the presentation.
Okay, I just finished in 2 minutes, I think.
Yes, sir. Yes.
And the poor survival, if delay in the diagnosis, may be treatment for the 6 years. The best prognosis in the disease when confined to a sinuses, but the poor prognosis when the brain is involved, the cranial nerve was involved, and both sides sinuses were involved. This is another case, I want to highlight this case because this patient having clear-cut indication of the excentration because the panophthalmitis were there, complete ophthalmoplegia was there, urine discharge was there. Patient already underwent sinus debridement surgery. He is on antifungal drug and also orbital excentration has been planned. I did the surgery nicely, clean all the margins. The next day patient was right. Even first follow-up after a week, the sutures were healthy. And 2 weeks after surgery, I found there with development of the sinoorbital fistula. While examining him clearly, I found there is facial swelling and I suspected the involving of the maxilla in this patient and referred the patient for the maxillary surgery. In the last conversation, I had the patient, he underwent some kind of palatal surgery or maxillary surgery and surviving. So there are a lot of complications are there in orbital excentration. It's not easy to perform surgery and forget about this. The intraoperative complication like hemorrhage, durometer exposure and CSFD, the postoperative complication like fistula formation, infection, necrosis. So the sequential MRI of the patient, regular watch of the patient, medication monitoring, long follow-up, everything is must after the surgery. So this is the last case I'm going to discuss, which is an interesting case because she is under follow-up since last 2 months. treated for the rhino-orbital mucormycosis in the form of systemic medication, sinus debridement. The eye is having no PL with the periocular pain and ptosis. When the first surgery was performed, they were sent for the biopsy and they found the fungal mixed bacteria here. After discussion with the neurologist and physician, because of the bacteria it was there and the antifungal course was completed, under antibiotic cover, we gave trial of the IVMP followed by the oral steroid for a month in tapering dose. And there is improvement in the swelling we were there. But to make a concluded diagnosis, whether it is a bacterial or fungal, the ENT surgeon performed the medial wall biopsy through the medial wall and the bacterial clebsiella were formed. In this patient, it's difficult to decide, the dilemma was there, whether we can give the retrobulbar amphotericin or we can observe. I prefer to observe the patient and the continuing of the antibiotic course. So sometimes in the current scenario, we overdiagnose the case of mucormycosis, that we must make sure that it is a case of mucor, but we should keep our minds open. The secondary structure possibility is definitely there in this type of patient, which can be bacterial as well as well. So I would like to conclude my case discussion with the message of, like, RHIOSAM is an emergency condition with no prior established treatment guideline and multiple hurdles in the treatment way, like the unavailability of the systemic amphotericin. There may be variable responses noted with the same treatment in different type of patient. The treatment needs multidisciplinary approach and has the psychological and financial burden over the patient as well as family. The best possible treatment option need to be discussed extensively with the patient and the attender with the empathy. Thank you. I want to acknowledge Dr. Arun Bhargav, Dr. Ekta, Dr. Kesho, because since last month we managed able to manage all the kind of cases with the team effort only. Thank you, everyone. Should I stop sharing screen?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. That was very interesting and gave us an insight into this the various surgical aspects. And I would like to invite our esteemed panel for any comments or questions.
This was very nice presentation, Dr. Animesh. I must congratulate you. In variety of patients, very presentation. You rightly said that in first case, no PL doesn't, and no PL and ophthalmoplegia doesn't mean you have to do the exaggeration. We have also seen many cases just giving the tram, treating them with tram and they recover. So this no PL may not be actually the direct equation of optical or person. We have to correlate everything. It's not only the patient symptoms, vision, but we have to correlate it with the sinus involvement and the MRI. That is very, very important. And after correlating everything, we have to take decision. And in second case also, you saw that second, third, I think there was diffuse orbital involvement, and even the MRI picture shows that there is necrotic this thing. So definitely we can't save this globe, and there was intracranial extension also. So we have to, frontal lobe abscess was there, so we have to do the exaggeration, which was rightly done. One case you showed that there was, after exaggeration, there was a patient died after 2 months, I think. So whatever is said, we see that even many times patient, they come to us, they say, ki this ER to kharab ho gayi, just take out this eye, this is the only life-saving thing. So we have to remember this. This is not the exaggeration, doesn't mean that you are saving the life of a patient. It depends on many things. Whether patient is getting amphotericin B, we have seen many patients, initially they get the amphotericin B and suddenly this is not available, systemic ampho is not available, so patients start deteriorating. And within 24 hours or 36 hours, you see the marked deterioration in their condition. So everything is, and good control of diabetes also, metabolic control also, that is also another very, very important thing. So these are my views, and fourth case you said about the renal transplant is already immunocompromised patient, and that patient died, I think. So,
right? Yeah, that patient I have to discuss with the neurologist, in the neurologist, yeah. And physician, ENT surgeon, I discussed it in detail. And
many times he rightly pointed out that while doing the exaggeration, I think we should go for the CT before doing the exenteration. That way you can see clearly what orbital walls are intact, where there is thinning or the communication is weak, walls are there. So we have to plan accordingly along with the neurosurgeons many times.
Yes, ma'am.
Neurosurgeon, OMFS surgeons, ENT. This is multi-speciality and you have to have all the surgeons in such situation in the OP. Very nice presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your valuable comments. I have a couple of questions for sir here. I think everyone would also like to know, sir, what is the dosage of the retrovalvar Amphob that you are using, sir?
That was 3.5 milligram per ml dose, and 1 ml dose is to be given on the basis of daily, or you can try it alternate days also. And sometimes many patients, some people are preferred to give a per day basis up to the 7 days also.
Okay.
Till now, basically, no straightforward guidelines for the retrovalvar. The dose is definitely 3.5 milligram 1 ml. Most of the people follow this.
Okay, sir. And sir, when you plan for an exenteration, do you prefer an endoscopic sinus clearance along with the exenteration, or you prefer it before or after the exenteration?
Most of the patient, when we do the exenteration, either it is with the ENT surgeon or post debridement surgery. So while we perform the surgery, the ENT surgeon also came to know and also examined with the endoscope whether the sinuses were cleared or not. And sometimes they prefer to wash the sinuses with the amphotericin B. So by taking patient to the OT already, there is also opportunity for the ENT person to clean the sinus again.
So here,
I would like to add one thing, Subit, if you permit. What he said is correct. Many times, seeing the clinical condition, MRI report, and then you can decide. But if the face is done before, whether to this exenteration is combined with the face, or you do the face first and then do the exenteration. That is also the first slide what he showed. Everything doesn't fit into one similar condition. That is very, very true. So you have to assess very cleverly.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Any other questions or comments?
If you permit, can I ask something?
Please, sir. Please.
So, Animesh, excellent presentation. I just wanted to know one basic thing. How do you follow these patients? Like when you have treated, let's say, day 14 to day 21, we all know it is now easy to diagnose mucor. We all are diagnosing it. But from an ophthalmologist point of view, what is the things that you take care on from day 14 to day 21 when the patients now, most of the patients are not getting amphotericin B? So how do you kind of see them? When do you see them? When do you call them? What are the guidelines that you give them to these patients? Just want to know about this.
So basically, what guidelines I follow, usually I want to observe patient very closely. Even immediately first post-operatively, if I operated the patient, then after 3 days, third day, 1 week, then 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, I usually remove the suture and I try to counsel the patient for the MRI again to see any increase or any progression of the disease. Also, I would like to have a checkup with the ENT person, or if that neurological involvement was there, should repeat the MRI and send the patient across the neurologist also. Regarding amphotericin B unavailability, it's difficult to answer this question because definitely patient is required amphotericin B, that is must, and we already exenterated the eye. So physician usually follow the keeping the patient on the posaconazole or sometimes sulfaconazole also. So we have to keep close watch on the progression of the disease definitely. And obviously for the rehabilitation person, if the patient is survived well and doing all things well, for the rehabilitation purpose, it usually done after 6 weeks up to the 2.5 months or 3 months. When everything is fine, then we can rehabilitate the patient with the artificial prosthesis.
Thank you, Animesh. Thank you.
Thanks. Any other questions? We have a couple of minutes. Okay. So that was a very good discussion. Thank you for your inputs, Arun sir and Shreya ma'am. Now I would like to move on to the next case. Our next presenter is Dr. Shweta Gupta. She is consultant oculoplasty and ocular oncology at Shankara Eye Hospital. Is Dr. Shweta ready?
Yes.
Please share your screen. Yeah. And a polite request to please stick to time. We have 8 minutes for presentation and 8 minutes for discussion.
So, Dr. Sumit, Sumit, is my slides visible?
Yes, yes, you can go full screen now. Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, so very good evening, everyone. So at the outset, I would like to thank IDOS for giving me this opportunity. So as Dr. Animesh has done my job very easy, so I'm going to take you through two cases. So the first case is a 37-year-old female. She presented to us with pain, swelling, and watering in the left eye since 10 days. She also had some complaint of runny nose, which was diagnosed as URTI by a general physician. And she was started on tablets, Cinarest, and Sensiclave. When she came to us on asking the history, she gave a history of COVID 1 month back, and she had recovered only with the home isolation. There is no history of hospitalization or oxygenation, and she had history of history of taking tablet dexamethasone for 1 week during the onset of the COVID. So on presentation to us, the visual acuity in the left eye was 6/12, but the intraocular pressures were slightly high. If we see the clinical picture, we can see there is mild proptosis in the left eye with severe ptosis. There was fullness in the superior sulcus. There was a diffuse chemosis all around, and there were limitation of extraocular movements in all the gazes. Her pupil was normally reacting, and the anterior segment and rest of the fundus findings were normal. On the checkup of her random blood sugars, she came out to be with her high blood sugars of 283 milligrams. So we advised her to get an imaging. She was not at all affording, so she planned to go with the CT scans. So in the CT scan also, we can see there is in the left side of ethmoid and as well as maxillary sinuses, there is hyperdense shadows and fullness of both the sinuses. As well as if we can see in the left orbit, there were slight edema of the left orbital extraocular muscles, and there was diffuse fat stranding in the left orbit. So she was having diffuse sinusitis and most likely fungal in view of her history. So we sent the patient to the ENT specialist who did a thorough sinus debridement, and the histopathology of which showed mucormycosis. The patient was not at all affording, so she had started amphotericin, deoxycholate, and followed by oral posaconazole for 1 week. And on 2 weeks of follow-up, there was drastic improvement in the extraocular muscles. There was a drastic improvement in the proptosis, ptosis, and her vision also improved to 6/6. So in this patient, only with the management by the ENT surgeon, high index of suspicion of the mucormycosis case, and along with the systemic antifungals, without any erythrobulbar amphotericin B or without any orbital intervention, we could save the patient's vision as well as patient's eye. So I'm taking you through the case number two. So he is again a young male of 27 years old. He he presented to us with pain and swelling in the right eye since 8 days. He also had history of COVID 3 weeks back. And for that, he isolated himself at home. There is no history of hospitalization or oxygen need, but he took prednisolone tablets for 2 weeks without any supervision. When he reported to me, he already underwent sinus debridement 1 week back, and the KOH mount and histopathology of which were suggestive of mucor. He had a history of retrobulbar amphotericin B. He already received injection IV amphotericin liposomal for 8 days, and he again had the high blood sugar levels for which he is on the anti-diabetic medications. So on presentation, in the visual acuity in the right eye was no PL. And he had very high intraocular pressures of 26 millimeter of mercury. Here we can see that there is again the fullness of superior sulcus. There is a severe proptosis in the right eye. There was diffuse conjunctival chemosis and the conjunctival tissue prolapse. There was a RAPD. And his fundus picture showed the diffuse retinal folds. However, though there was no evidence of any CRAO or any disc edema. So we ordered imaging for him. So the imaging, the axial cut shows the post-operative changes of the sinus surgery. We can see that the in the right orbit, in the lateral part, there is diffuse hyperintense shadowing in the lateral part of the orbit, which is extending from the anterior orbit till the posterior orbit, till the orbital apex in the sagittal cuts. We can see that the lesion is involving the lesion in the coronal cuts. It is multilobulated lesion, which is involving the intraconal as well as the extraconal part of the right orbit. And the lesion cannot be seen separately from the all muscles. However, the good thing is there was a good enhancement of all the extraocular muscles. The patient went for a consultation of an ophthalmologist. It was planned for excentration, and the patient came for the second opinion. His age is 27 years. He was not at all keen for the excentration. So I took a chance and planned for the lateral orbitotomy with this debridement of that loculi and along with the retrobulbar amphotericin B. And to my surprise, the microbiology came out to be a combined infection, a mixed infection of mucor as well as aspergillus. And the histopathology showed the same. So the patient was advised to continue the IV amphotericin B, and now he has already completed 18 days of amphotericin, and he was started on oral posaconazole on the same time when he was diagnosed with the aspergillus. So on post treatment around 2 weeks, he is still on oral posaconazole. He is on anti-diabetic medications, and we are following him on the serial MRI scans. So to conclude, it is very important in mucormycosis to treat the patient and not the scans, because as Dr. Animesh Sahu sir has already told that one size does not fit to all. So we have to look at all the aspects. We have to look at the systemic issues, the associated comorbidities, the diabetic status, and the patient's readiness for the surgery. So if we are planning for an excentration, even in the diffuse involvement eyes, always give a second thought. If we can plan a local debridement or a conservative treatment, at least we can give a second chance, because excentration is a radical surgery and it is a huge psychological impact to the patient. And it is not only the eye. As Dr. Shreya Madam has already told, we need to look for the strict diabetic control. Nowadays, these patients are getting amphotericin B without any nephrologist or without any endocrinologist or physician consult, and these patients are developing renal failure. There are few patients which have recovered from mucormycosis nicely, surgical debridement, everything is done, but they died due to renal failure. So we have to do a multidisciplinary approach, and we have to take care of the patient as a whole. We need an ENT surgeon, we need a neurologist, neurosurgeon, maxillofacial surgeon, as well as a very good physician to follow these patients. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Shweta. That was an excellent presentation. Particularly interesting was the presence of both aspergillus and mucor in your case. I would like to now invite our panel for any valuable questions or comments or suggestions.
So in her both the cases, the diabetes was uncontrolled. That was the one thing. And second one, in first case, just with debridement of the sinuses, she cured. And similar thing we have seen even in the second case also, she did only the lateral orbitotomy, not the excentration completely. So this is effect of all these combined things. Means control of diabetes phase and then the removal of fungal load by removing that load from the lateral orbitotomy. So we have also seen one case in which phase was done. The picture was similar. The clinical picture was similar as she has shown in the second case. But somehow we could not get the fitness from the neurology. And so phase was done, but we have not done the exenteration. We planned for the exenteration, but after phase, with systemic amphotericin B, patient symptoms and clinical signs, everything was reduced. So it's not like that, that you see the very aggressive picture or very alarming picture and you have to directly go for the exenteration. You can give some time to the patient, what she said correctly.
Thank you, ma'am. That's actually very, very true, because excentration is a very life-changing surgery for any patient. And we should really give a chance for a little more conservative therapy before going for excentration. It is just like we give pre-surgery radiation for cancers and we debug the cancer before going for surgery. Any other comments? Arun, sir?
Yeah, Dr. Shweta, excellent presentation. Case one was, I guess, a very straightforward cakewalk, but very nicely managed. Case two, Dr. Shweta, there are certain things which I would like to know.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
Just what is the follow-up that you've had? Did you do a follow-up MRI post-lateral orbitotomy?
Yes, sir. We have follow-up MRI post-orbitotomy, one big follow-up, which is showing regressed disease with fibrosis in the operated area.
Yeah, but I guess it was not shown in the presentation.
Yes, sir. That actually, the patient has sent me the reports and scans. It is the patient is not like willing for the follow up.
So, Dr. Shweta, why do a lateral orbitotomy? Just give him IV ampho. Why intervene? Because you see, let's understand the involvement was from anterior to posterior. There was apical involvement, right?
Yes,
so
yes.
We couldn't have debulked the posterior orbit or the apical, the lesion and the debris which was there in the apex, right? If I'm right?
Yes, sir. But the lesion was involving the inferolateral quadrant. So we have
it
to
was
go...
extending to the apex. It was
yes, yes. It was extending till the apex and it was more of an inferior, as I showed in the sagittal section, it is more in the inferior part. So I did transconjunctival inferior orbitotomy extending to the lateral orbitotomy.
Deep lateral. My point is like you've done, but you also know you wouldn't have done a 100% job.
Sir, I have sent the tissues and the patient is responding. I am following the patient 1 week. I have convinced the patient that you may need excentration, but I have given a chance to the patient. And till 2 weeks of the orbitotomy, he is doing well. And he is like systemically, he is doing well. And the sugars are controlled. So I'm hoping he will do better. And I want to add, not only this patient, I am following few of the patients who have been received 2 weeks of IV amphotericin B, 2 to 3 weeks of IV amphotericin, along with the only sinus debridement done. They are having diffuse orbital involvement. But now if we will see the clinical picture of those patients, it is showing the fibrosis. Yes. So actually, the injection IV amphotericin is also reaching there if the orbit is not devitalized, like the loss of contrast enhancement and other features. Then these patients are actually improving with the IV amphotericin B. So my surgery only debulked that dead necrotic tissue. And luckily, that patient came out to be a mixed picture. So in Aspergillus, actually, it is a crime to excentrate.
That's
it is showing Aspergillus, then we have to give a chance. So I'm not in a hurry to do excentration. I'm following, I'm getting clinically as well as radiologically, more clinically. And the patient is showing good response. So I don't have any convincing evidence to show that I should excentrate. So I'm following him. Maybe I'll share if I'll have 1 month or 2 months of follow-up with the same conservative treatment.
So when you have Aspergillus, why not start him with on voriconazole?
Sir, I have discussed with the infectious disease specialist also. They are telling if we are starting on the voriconazole, then it can increase the growth of mucor. So it is very controversial. And posaconazole act against both mucor as well as efficacy against the Aspergillus as well. So it is covering both. And good response is shown in the patient. That means it is working. So I'm happy with that.
It would be nice if you would have shown the post-surgical MR. That would have been really nice to suggest.
Yeah, I'll maybe at the end of the webinar, I'll show, I'll just great. Transfer.
Great job done, Shweta.
Yes, okay. Great thank great. You, sir. Thank you.
Dr. Shweta, I am also having one question. Yes. May I ask?
Please, sir, please.
Yeah. My question is, ki, like, when you found mucor and aspergillus both,
yes, sir.
Whether it is found in face also or only in the orbital tissue or in the which part of the orbital mucormycosis, whether it is in the orbit you found the mixed infection or in face also you found the mixed infection?
Sir, the face is done by the ENT surgeon and it is shown only mucor and mucor on KOH as well as histopathology. And aspergillus is found in the orbital examination on both KOH mount culture as well as fungal culture as well as histopathology. So, and it was in the more in the inferior part. Maybe I'll try to show that inferior orbitotomy picture I have. So in that necrosed area, that multiloculated region I showed in the MRI, in that area it was shown.
Because till now, what usually we attend the webinar, it's rare case, I think, because the mixed infection, I didn't find anywhere. Maybe the chances that maybe the normal flora
yes, sir. I have discussed with three microbiologists and they told that if it is only normal flora, then it will not go grow on culture. But if it is growing on the culture, then it means it's not normal flora because it will not have that much of concentration. So it is the pathology. And I have cross-checked with the two microbiologists. It is actually one of the rare cases.
Yeah,
one of the rare
cases.
Yes, sir.
One suggestion, if I can make. Did you do an ultrasound, an orbital mode ultrasound for this patient?
No, sir. I have
because you know, you had those retinal folds that indicate there is a posterior push mechanism which is happening through. So you could have actually, you don't need any MR or for this. You could have actually on an orbital mode of an ultrasound, you could have judged the anterior-posterior dimensions of that debris or that loculated mass. And probably post-surgery, you know, it would have been very interesting to see that itself. That your intervention, because the level of lateral orbitotomy, we would have easily gained an access through the orbital mode of ultrasound. So we could have that probably if the patient comes back to you, you can just do an lateral.
Yes, sir. I can try that. But the thing is, the pre-FES MRI, which the patient has done around a week back before my orbitotomy surgery, that was also showing the lesion extending till the apex. So my the aim of doing MRI was not only to see the orbital part, also to see the extent beyond the apex. So no, that beyond the that,
yes. This is something like an office procedure that you can do it on our own.
Yes. Additionally, but I can do it.
Because you have a posterior push mechanism. You had retinal folds in your fundus findings. So that indicates there is a posterior push mechanism which is occurring through.
Yes,
so
sir. That was
posterior push that could be judged on an ultrasound.
Yes, sir. Next time the patient will come, I'll do it. Mm-hmm. And the patient was having a lot of intraorbital pressure. So on the follow-up, I don't have that photo. But on follow-up, there was all the retinal folds which formed, which were present during or before the surgery, they have subsided. So
that's that indicates that your procedure helped the patient.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you for the suggestion.
Two things were there, which were very rare. First is with only orbital involvement showed the mucor plus aspergillus, which was not there in the sinus. And second thing, it was involving the inferior lateral part going there. Usually you see the medial wall involvement first and then it extends. So that's why your lateral orbitotomy was helpful in this case.
It spreaded from the infraorbital fissure to the orbital part from the sinuses.
Indeed, we are having a very good discussion. We are also getting views from the YouTube live and we have questions from there also. So a couple of questions we can take now. What should be the discharge criteria from ophthal side? Because many of us are interested, what is an ophthalmologist? What is a person who's not doing oculoplasty? What should be the discharge criteria from ophthal side? When you feel that your work is done, now it's over to the ENT people or the neurologist. It's open for the panel or the speaker.
Dr. Sumit, I would like to add some input regarding that case 2 of Dr. Shweta and the current question you are asking.
Yes, sir, please.
First of all, I am very glad that so much people are interested in orbit and oculoplasty and doing a great work in the city. As far as what should be the discharge criteria from ophthalmic side, if we are giving retrobulbar injections on regular basis, and if we are seeing some improvement in vision, not in vision, some improvement in ocular movement, that can be the sign of discharge from ophthalmic side. If we are planning orbital excentration surgery, then what I am doing in my regular practice after doing excentration, I am doing dressing on the day two of the surgery, and then from our side the patient is discharged. As far as follow-up scans are concerned, I order usually scan day 7 and day 14 from the excentration to see whether the patient is getting good effect of intra IV amphotericin or not, or whether the patient is having any chance of infection in the apex of the orbit. Rest the time of the discharge is as the patient is we get the some signs of improvement in the orbit after our injection. As far as injections are concerned, I am not very convinced from the retrobulbar injection of amphotericin B. And the today's scenario is that we are not having amphotericin for IV use. So I have completely left doing the retrobulbar injections. Regarding the case 2 of Dr. Shweta is concerned, it is a really interesting case. I have seen that patient, and currently patient is follow up with me, and he is doing quite well. He has regained all his ocular movements. And as far as my last 1.5 months of practice in cyano-orbital mucormycosis, I have seen neurological recovery in the patient who are young and having a very little involvement of orbit. They are regaining very fast. They are having very good recovery of neurological symptoms like ocular movements or even they have regained vision also. So the patient was a very good case. He has been managed very well. The role of lateral orbitotomy was a little doubtful for me. And take the orbital tissue and getting it biopsied, because already the sinus biopsy, we have got mucor in the biopsy report, and we have patient is already on the amphotericin, and currently patient has been discharged and put on oral posaconazole, and he is doing quite well. So what I think is systemic therapy of antifungal is the crucial part of the treating sino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis, and of course removal of necrotic tissue is the key. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. One more question is there. Is there any role of topical amphoB? Anyhow, should it be given, should not be given?
Topical amphotericin, it has not been seen written anywhere in the protocol. So it should not be given. Even I am seeing in a lot of hospitals I am visiting, and I am seeing that patients are instilling local natamycin eye drop and local fluconazole eye drop, or even some patients put on cycloplegic eye drop like atropine or homoid. Those that are absolutely not necessary. Absolutely not.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Even better to start antibiotic eye drop, so it will prevent the secondary infection.
True. That is. Okay, I think we should move on to our third presenter for the evening. Our next presenter is Dr. Sonam Verma. She is an assistant professor at SAMC and PG Institute. Dr. Sonam, please, are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Please share your screen and start your presentation.
Is it on?
Yes, we can see.
So I'll be presenting 4 cases, which are predominantly COVID-associated mucormycosis. So I'm first of all going to acknowledge our big department of faculty members and the resident force who are working day and night for all the patients. Currently, we are handling up to 50 patients of mucormycosis and have dedicated wards. So first case is of a COVID-positive patient. He is a 70 years old gentleman with long history of diabetes and hypertension. the diagnosis was made on May 1st, and there was 4 days of history of ICU stay, along with the steroids given very early on the fourth day itself with the intravenous route. During the stay, he has reported of fluctuating levels of fasting blood glucose, and at the same time, the highest documented sugar went up to 460 milligrams per day. And along with that, there was predisposing factor of use of super antibiotics, and also there was a poor oral and dental hygiene care. Now, the patient is currently on NRBM. So this patient so far has not been able to recover from COVID till now. We were referred, we were sent the referral 2 days back, and the first signs also had started appearing on 21st of May. So with the ongoing COVID infection, we cannot intervene exactly, but at the same time here, as we can see, in the right eye, we had PL positive vision, which was recorded, and in the right side, we had finger counting more than 5 feet. But here we can see this, we did inquire about these marks. So they were actually not because of the mask itself, but these are the ASCAR signs, which were known. And secondly, along with that, in the MRI also, we saw that on imaging, the orbital involvement is not as much. So currently, we are preferring to stay conservative with antifungals, not even to release you. And we are co-managing the case with respiratory medicine, or ENT, and medicine departments. Moving on to my next case. Now, this person is a 48-year-old gentleman, newly diagnosed diabetic, was COVID positive on April 19th, and there was no history of ICU stay, and although he was hospitalized, and on May 9th, he was given RT-PCR negative report, but on admission, since the day of admission, and we see over here, like on 19th over here, and at the end of that week itself, he was started on steroids, with very uncontrolled level of sugars between 250 and 400, again use of super antibiotics. And although the oral and dental hygiene care were up to the mark, and the patient was on supplemental oxygen therapy. So these were particular things which we were concerned about, which may have predisposed to infection with mucormycosis. Now the first symptom started appearing on May 8th. And when the case was referred to us, he had already undergone first phase surgery done on May 9th, so right after he was declared COVID negative. So the patient had lost vision in his right eye along with total ophthalmoplegia, and he showed signs of CRAO in his right eye, although the left eye was appearing normal with a good vision. Here we did think of going for excentration according to the scoring system. But on MRI, although with quite extensive involvement, the neurosurgery department told that he's having extensive CNS involvement along with bilateral cavernous sinus thrombosis. So we had to steer our ways clear from going towards any invasive intervention. The patient started showing a bit of improvement in his general condition when he started getting liposomal amphotericin B continuously, and he received a total of 13 doses, and as soon as it was unavailable, he was continued on posaconazole. So till now, the case is still admitted with us, and under the Department of Neurosurgery, Neurology, ENT, and Medicine, we are co-managing the case, and his general condition has improved, along with the eye over here showing slight regression in the chemosis and congestion, which we are looking. Although till now, the ophthalmoplegic component and the vision are not back because of some obvious reasons. Moving forward to the third case, he's a 45-year-old gentleman diagnosed with COVID on April 13th, and he was on home isolation. On May 16th, he was an RT-PCR negative patient, but he informed that he started having the symptoms of correlatable with the sinusitis only during the very early phase of getting infected. That was on 20th April itself. So there was no history of use of steroids, super antibiotics, voriconazole or echinocandins in his COVID duration. And although the highest level of sugars were documented to be 360, with an oral and dental hygiene of considerably good level. Now, when the patient was referred to us, he was in his COVID positive phase. And that time we had to wait for around a week for him to get declared negative. And meanwhile, he couldn't have amphotericin B. He was still on posaconazole. His general condition started deteriorating. So along with phimosis congestion worsening, there was complete visual loss and total internal of of thanatopsia. So there we had to.
Sorry to interrupt you, Dr. Sonam. Please wind up. You're running out of time.
Okay. So here we had to plan an MRI to decide upon whether to go invasive. So cavernous sinus thrombosis were ruled out. We underwent procedure of excentration on May 21st under GA. Then continued with antifungals and regular dressing on 2 days interval. On histopathology, we saw large granulomas near the optic nerve sheath and also septate hyphae. And so far, the patient is doing good. The last case is of a COVID negative patient, 41 years old. In this patient, there was the following features. And of uncontrolled sugar and super antibiotics being used. After being declared COVID negative, after 2 weeks, he started having the features of sinusitis. And although the vision was maintaining good, one day he had sudden drop of vision less than finger counting 3 feet. And on radiological imaging, we didn't see very extensive involvement. There was slight hypertensive signals on the retroorbital fat. So we decided to go for a tram, and we gave it on May 24th. The vision was restored after 2 days to its normalcy, and the fullness was slightly recovered. The patient is discharged as of now. So for summary, the mainstay should be FEST, continuous antifungal administration, metabolic control. What else we learned was a multidisciplinary approach, but not polytherapy. Early and judicious line of management, along with grading and the Sino Hospital scoring system to make decisions for excentration. And please don't quit on tram, although I do agree with the senior faculties that we do have to choose our case selectively. So far, we are still picking up on it, how to do that properly. And excentration is feasible only in a very narrow window. And as I indicated earlier, that only visual loss, proptosis, and ophthalmoplegia should not requite it. And imaging should be relied upon for going for any kind of debridement surgery within last 24 hours, an image of last 24 hours. And we must know when not to intervene invasively. And from all the battle right now, we learned first take one day at a time. It's a long battle within a war. Thank you so much. And I would like to thank the other departments at our hospital.
Thank you, Dr. Sonam. They were all in very interesting cases. I open the forum for discussion among the panel.
Dr. Sonam, I want to ask one question.
Yes, sir.
That in the third case, while they are, you stop the sharing screen.
Sorry, sir.
The patient presented to you first on, I think, April.
No, sir. The patient was on home isolation. So he first showed in the department, like he was actually admitted.
Third case, I'm asking.
Yeah. So he was at home. And the first time we saw was on May 14th.
May 14th.
Yes, sir. So 2 days he was a COVID positive patient when he was in our hospital.
And when the MRI has been done?
MRI, it was done a day before the surgery, so it was on 20th of May. Yes, sir.
So, while that time you haven't given amphotericin B or anything for the eye?
So, we started with the tablet posaconazole because amphotericin B was not available at the time.
But I feel it's like if the availability of amphotericin, like systemic amphotericin, is not possible, everyone knows.
Yes.
If you have a small amount, you can at least, we can at least, what I feel is my personal opinion, that I can try to give some concentration in orbit also. So at least he should have some amount of drug in the orbit.
Yes.
So the disease, the progression of the disease may be a little bit delayed. Still the reports are awaited for the TRAM.
Yes.
But you can try, because it was a matter of 1 ml only. So if you have one injection, you can give 10 patients even.
Yes, sir. So actually, like just for discussion purpose, like what factor was limiting us at the point was that whether the patient has undergone first FES or not, and we wanted to combine it with the FES surgery. Please state if I'm wrong. Like we can always make a change according to your expertise.
Mm-hmm.
FES
is the first thing.
So the patient had not undergone his FES until that 21st of May. So before that, is it a good thing to give retrobulbar in a separate setting? Like just bedside or like maybe just...
Retrobulbar, I don't think retrobulbar is required major OT thing, because it is a minor OPD procedure only.
Yes,
obviously, if you are having an OT, it would be better.
Yes,
but at least I think if you are not getting the sufficient amount of IV amphotericin B, or you are not getting at all amphotericin B, if you have a small amount of drug, you can inject at least.
Yes,
what
sir.
I feel.
Yes, sir. So it's fine to give it before the first phase, sir.
Maybe people different opinion, but what I prefer that at least we can, because nowadays we are seeing there is shortage of the amphotericin.
Yes.
So at least we can give the retrobarba so that at least minimum small amount of concentration would be there in the orbit.
Yes, sir.
Maybe for a day or two, I don't know. Maybe.
I would like to intervene here. We are getting questions regarding retrobulbar only. What is the number of injections that we can give? And what is the end point?
See, till now, there is no clear-cut guidelines for giving retrobulbar. How much you can give, but usually what people used to follow, what are the information we got from all over the India, at least minimum 3 injection people used to give minimum, but there is a report that people are given 7 days, 7 injection. And obviously we cannot repeat the MRI on a daily basis. So we have to wait for 7 days or even more than 7 days, 10 days up. Then we can repeat the MRI and see the result, whether the disease is regressing or progression is there. So basically, till now, we are also waiting for the guide. Is there any guideline for TRAM? But till now, I don't think people are following their own way. Like few people are, like I used to give at least 3 injection in every patient. If I started, I give 3 injection at least.
Dr. Sumit, I
yes,
want
sir.
To add some input.
Please, please.
As
I was going
as
to ask you. Yes.
Retrobulbar injection is concerned. According to Agoraplasty Association of India Mucormycosis Treating Group, they are advising to give retrobulbar amphotericin B injection, the dose as all of us know, 3.5 milligram per ml, quantity can be 1 ml or at the max 2 ml. And they are advising that injection should be repeated daily or with a 1 day gap. And the injection number of injections are advised are 7. But till date, I was very keen in doing the TRAM injections at the last week of April and even in the first week of May, but not got a satisfactory result regarding the halt in the progression of the disease of the orbit. And also, we cannot document by radiological or clinical method that we can prevent the disease after injecting the medicine in the orbit. So it is only the systemic, that is IV medication, that is only helpful for treating the orbital disease also. Sinus debridement, of course, it is a crux of the treatment. Sinus debridement should be done as early as possible and which should be followed by injection amphotericin B. The dose which the physician can calculate depending upon the tissues they are involving. Like if the patient is having only maxillary sinus involvement, they can have a dose of 50 milligrams. If they are having maxilla, ethmoid and sphenoid involvement, we can give 200 milligrams per day dose of amphotericin B. And if are having 10 sinusitis involving frontal, sphenoid, maxilla, ethmoid and on the both sides along with the orbit, we can give up to 400 milligrams per day. and depending upon the progression or depending upon the recovery of the patient, then they used to taper off the dose. So my point here to stress is only and only IV amphotericin or oral posaconazole if the amphotericin is not available, that are giving the result to the patient and not the retrobulbar injection.
Sir, regarding the formulation of Amfo-P, is the dosage different for conventional liposomal or the aqueous-based type of Amfo-P? Is the dosage different?
The ideal injection to be used for Orbit is liposomal, but of course it is not available nowadays. So we are giving deoxycholate, and the dose is 3.5. But to for the ease of the for preparing the injection, we are giving 2.5 milligram at one site, because the vial comes with a 50 milligram. By diluting the vial with a 10 ml of distilled water, we are getting 5 milligram per ml, and that 5 milligram we can inject at the two sites. So that becomes 2.5 milligram per ml. That is easy for calculation. We cannot give exactly 3.5. It is difficult to calculate.
And any downsides, what are the potential toxicities with the retrobulbar dose of a highly toxic drug like Amfo-B?
Yeah. Till date, no toxicity has been observed for the local use of amphotericin B. Many Orbit surgeons are giving the injection as right and left, and even the anterior segment surgeons are now giving right and left injection in the Orbit, just like they are giving lignocaine inside the Orbit. But still, it is a safer drug, and we are giving it a very, very low dose. So it is a good practice if anyone wants to do.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your input. Any other comments, suggestions, questions?
What we are doing in our institute, that when there is medial wall or medial side of the orbit is involved more than the diffuse one, so ENT people, they are just removing the medial wall and doing the debridement, and that we have seen quite helpful. So in cases where we are thinking of very we have to go for the exenteration or we are in dilemma, but after phase and removing that medial wall, the patient is improving. So that is another thing, and they are just washing it with the info, and we are giving retrobulbar info along with the face in that cases, in those cases. So I think that can be done to save the eye.
Right, ma'am.
Dr. Sumit, I want to add one comment.
Please, Doc. Please.
So regarding the toxicity of retrobulbar amphotericin B, there have been experience of having orbital compartment syndrome. So because if we are giving in only one quadrant, so it may cause a sudden increase in the orbital pressure, and sudden loss of vision also can happen. So if this thing is happening, or if the proptosis is so much, and already as in my case, I have shown that few retinal folds are there, which are, and the posterior compression of the retina, then in such cases, we depending on the MRI scan and the inflammation and the disease process, we can give in the multiple quadrants. Still, if we are feeling that there is an increase in the, there might be an increase in the intraorbital pressure, then we can do a lateral canthotomy and the right. Inferior cantholysis. So that may be a safer option in order to save the optic nerve.
Right.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Sonam, I found one thing a little, I have doubts about the second case which you presented, in which you were not given clearance for exenteration by the neuro department. Yes. Why exactly was that?
They were saying that whenever there's a cavernous sinus involvement, there's a high chances, like almost to 100%, that a patient can pass away on the table itself. So the surgery at this point of time is going to be risking lives. So at a very high degree. And is your procedure a life-saving procedure? So
okay,
that actually caught us in midst of a path. And actually it's something where we can't leave things half done. That if we just do FES and then we go ahead with the exenteration, but in the same setting, if we don't have the neurosurgeons supporting the surgery so that they can handle the CNS involvement with surgical involvement, I mean, from their side, it is, I think, we better off not to go ahead with that kind of a setting. And also from the past papers where there was so extensive kind of CNS involvement, I kind of observed along with their discussion that in such patients, keeping ourselves conservative towards a continuous higher dose of antifungals, although the patient will require a longer duration of admission with us, but he'll have rather more greater chances at surviving than just like giving the same set of patients undergoing surgeries.
So probably his cavernous sinus thrombosis saved him from an excentration. Yeah. Otherwise, he would have gone in an excentrated.
Dr. Sumit, can I just to this please, add something further? Yeah.
Please, sir.
Dr. Sonam, wonderful presentation. But just to add a couple of points which I found interesting. Like you said, there was probably a cavernous sinus involvement. I guess we need to define whether it's an anterior cavernous sinus involvement on the MRI and also on the clinical signs.
Yes.
So your other eye involvement, other eye muscle movements also make a huge amount of impact on the treatment decision.
Yes.
I guess till the level of anterior cavernous sinus involvement, you can still go ahead and do a surgical intervention without major risk to it.
Yes, sir. Yes. So that was like as in the third case of the place where we did excentration. There were probable signs of cavernous sinus thrombosis, and they did say that there is. But on further evaluation, they said that, but still you are, this is a better case to go for excentration rather than the one.
That's exactly my point. So you have to define your level of cavernous sinus involvement
yes.
also.
Yes.
Second, one very, very major point that we all need to understand that posaconazole doesn't have much of a penetration in CSF.
Yes.
Even in the inflamed tissues. So posaconazole does not have much of a role when you have a cerebral involvement.
Yes, sir.
So till the level it is restricted to rhino, definitely you, even in orbital, there is a question mark which comes up. And definitely in cerebral part, it has no role. So in all circumstances, IV amphotericin B or an esavoconazole also can be tried. But also just alone on a cerebral mucor will not help the patient much. Yes, I know the crunch is there. All of us have patients who don't, but this is just this point which I just wanted to mention further, that posaconazole doesn't have much of a CSF penetration. In fact, there are studies which were published in 2014-15 about the level of penetration of antifungals, and they clearly said that CSF does not have any penetration. Even the brain tissue doesn't have, for that matter, even an inflamed tissue. So we have to be very clear when you are dealing a combined ROCM, you have to be very clear with that.
So adding on to the point just regarding the imaging, one thing we found useful was reviewing the image along with the radiology department to ask whether the optic nerve is showing optic neuritis or because of angioinvasion or it is because of the inflammation around it. So that has been quite important to us while making such decisions of going surgically.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, one of the questions which has come up is since one of the patients was COVID positive on admission, so how do we take a patient who is COVID positive and is still having mucormycosis? So what should be the management line in such patients? Because these patients cannot undergo sinus debridement early.
I would like to add this. I would like to give the answer to this question.
Please, sir.
I have treated the patient who are having sino-orbital disease in with the COVID positive status. So it is not like that we cannot operate these patients. We get their MRI done, and if we are getting the sino-orbital disease or even a sinus involvement, our ENT colleagues, they are very where they are having quite a good daring to get this patient operated in a COVID OT and get their functional endoscopic sinus surgery done, and even along with their pneumonitis medications, the physician are starting them with the IV amphotericin or IV cascopyrgin, and that's how they are improving. So even if the patient is COVID positive, we have to treat the sinorbital mucormycosis with the same vigor as we are treating them in a non-COVID patient. Thank you.
I would like to now hand over the meeting to Dr. Manushri. She will be taking us through the rest of the three presentations. Over to you, Doctor.
Thank you, Dr. Sumit. So now we have a budding ophthalmologist, Dr. Divya Khandelwal from MGM Medical College, who would be presenting her case series of mucormycosis. Over to Dr. Divya.
Today I'm discussing some cases based on mucormycosis. So let's start with case number one. Case number one is having only sinus involvement. A 26-year-old male who was COVID positive 1 week ago, having presenting complaints of left facial pain and numbness, no history of fever, ptosis, headache, and proptosis, and vision loss was there. On examination, visual acuity in both eyes was counting finger more than 3 feet. PR was accurate. Pupil was central circular reacting to light, and extraocular movement was present in all cardinal gazes, and fundus was normal. So an imaging shows involvement of left maxillary and ethmoid sinus with sphenoid sinus involvement. Liposomal IV injection amphotericin B along with debridement done by our ENT department. Repeat MRI was done after ENT intervention after 10 days of hospitalization. And it showed that infection has regressed. And because of early diagnosis and management, spread of infection through orbit and brain can be prevented. Now, moving to case number two, having early orbital involvement, a 33-year-old male who was COVID positive 10 days ago, having diabetes, HbA1c at presentation was 13.65%, and while RBS was 345 milligram per deciliter, he presented with complaints of drooping of left eye, and on examination, left eye vision was counting finger more than 3 feet. Mild ptosis was there, extraocular movement, mild restriction present, conjunctiva was congested as seen in figure, and fundus was within normal limit. Severe left maxillary ethmoid and frontal sinusitis was there in imaging. And imaging also shows extension of inflammatory process in left orbital superior medial aspect causing proptosis and retroorbital inflammation as seen in these MRI pictures. So for management, 3 intraorbital amphotericin B injections were given on alternate days. Along with this, surgical debridement with IV amphotericin B was also given. And after 7 days, improvement in ptosis and extraocular movement was noticed. This is the video showing improvement in movement. Also, ptosis also has been improved. Moving on to case number three, orbital cellulitis with diabetes. A 52-year-old male, newly diagnosed diabetes, FBS on presentation was 240 milligram percent, HbA1c was 13.35%, and CRP was 16 milligram percent. He was COVID positive 1 month ago and received treatment of tablet dexamethasone 4 milligram BD, presented with complaints of headache, pain, left facial swelling, and numbness with left eye complete ptosis, left eye mild proptosis, and vision loss. No history of fever was there. On examination of left eye, vision was no PL, conjunctiva was chemos and congested, pupil was mid-dilated, non-reacting to light, extraocular movement completely absent, and fundus examination shows optic atrophy of the same eye. Imaging shows left orbital cellulitis with left maxillary and bilateral ethmoid sinusitis. For management, 5 intraorbital amphotericin B injection 3.5 mg per ml was given on alternate days. And for sinusitis, surgical intervention was done by ENT department. After 15 days, we saw that ptosis and extraocular movement are improved. Repeat MRI was done, which showed mild inflammatory changes. And CRP was also came to normal level. So this is video showing improvement in extraocular movements.
Video are not visible.
Ma'am, you will have to stop screen share and then play the video because it is in another window that way. Yeah, currently only your PPT is visible. once you open your video, you can again share your screen and select the video to be shared.
I'm not able to share screen now.
Okay, move to third case.
Yes. Third case has already been discussed. There was improvement in ectosis and extraocular movement. Now moving towards case number four, having extensive orbital involvement with cerebral involvement. A 42-year-old male, COVID positive 2 months ago, presented with complaints of headache, complete ptosis, vision loss and proptosis. On examination, vision was no PL, conjunctiva chemos and congested with black eschar, as seen in this picture. Pupil was mid-dilated, non-reacting to light, and extraocular movement was completely restricted. Imaging shows right orbital cellulitis with pan-sinusitis and inflammatory changes in brain. Three injections of intraorbital amphotericin B were given. No improvement seen, so we have to excentrate the eye. So key points.
Go full screen here. Sorry to interrupt. You can go full screen.
Yes, ma'am.
This last slide, let's carry on.
So key points are multidisciplinary and timely care is the key. Initiate therapy with less morbid procedures and have mercy on the infected eye. Don't rush for excentration. Thank you.
Very nicely, you have discussed different types of cases and different approaches towards different types of cases. I would like expert comments from the panel.
Nicely written that have a mercy on the infected eye. So the surgeons doing excentration are, I think they are monsters or something like that. They are doing not doing mercy on the eye. So it is better, it is always a very difficult decision to excentrate or not to excentrate. Excentration is of course not for the eye, it is to save the life of the patient. So it is a decision of choice. It is a decision whenever it is required. So there is no role of mercy in this. The presentation was nice, and all the cases were very nicely managed. Thank you.
Thanks. What the patient is there is sudden change, sudden drop of vision, sudden loss of vision, or sudden increase in the symptoms and the condition is going worse. And there is in that situation, sometimes after phase also, and we are treating the patient, following the patient, but there is sudden drastic change within 72 hours or 24 hours. So in this, so in those cases, there is some disturbance. I don't know. So in those cases, I think excentration is needed in such situation. Otherwise, so worsening is there within 72 hours or so with the case she has shown. In those cases, we have to excentrate. Otherwise, you can give that chance to the eye.
Manushya, I want to add one more thing.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Nimishyan. I want to add one more thing that till now, last 1 month, we are having almost clear-cut guideline for the exemption, not for the TRAM or not for the other special. But at least for exemption, as Bhagishar told rightly, that at least we have a clear-cut guidelines when you have to exempt it. So we all know that in which patient we cannot do any other thing. So I think they better go for the exemption. Still, the patients, those are not having the clear-cut guideline, they are not fitting in the clear-cut indication for the exemption. Those patients we can observe closely.
Regarding the retrobulbar amphotericin B, we have questions from the YouTube that is there any role of anti-glaucoma therapy, and especially when we are suspecting the compartment syndrome, and is the pressure can be a big issue in retrobulbar, which is being given repeatedly. So is there any role of anti-glaucoma therapy there?
See, if till now there is no role of glaucoma, anti-glaucoma therapy has been proven. With the compartment syndrome, is there the eye distracting, we have to do the lateral canthoplasty. That is the only option here. I don't think any reports is suggested for giving anti-glaucoma medication with the retrobulbar till now. And maybe...
So now we'll move to the next speaker. Next speaker is Dr. Akshita. She is from Index Medical College. Dr. Akshita.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Ida, for giving me this opportunity. I'm going to share my experience of coming at par with these patients. I am currently a second year resident in Index Medical College, and our college being a hub for COVID patients. So all these patients that we came through, we were called for emergencies, and we were actually serving in COVID, but these were the calls that were made. So my case first is a 49-year-old male who was an electrician by occupation and a resident of Indore. He had complaints of diminution of vision in right eye since 3 days, swelling in right eye since 3 days, and drooping of right eye upper lid since 2 days. Now, the patient was already admitted in our ICU, and he had tested positive 10 days back with a CT severity score of 20/25. And it is then that he started to experience diminution of vision, which was painless, sudden in onset, and progressively increasing. Swelling and paresthesia in the right periorbital area, forehead and cheek, and it was persistently present, and it was not relieved by any sort of medication. Also, severe ptosis was associated with mild proptosis was present since 2 days. Now, the patient was on high flow oxygen support at 10 liters per minute. There were multiple broad spectrum antibiotics that we had been giving him, which included meropenem, pibzo, etc. Steroids like IV methylprednisolone 40 mg BD was being administered. There was no history of diabetes, hypertension, TB, and the patient had no history of any vaccination against COVID. So this is the patient. He was in ICU when the call was made. And this is the first day that I saw him. The right eye vision was PL negative. All the extraocular movements were restricted. There was ptosis, the lids were swollen, lashes matted. There was chemosis, which was prominent. The cornea, although clear, the sheen was absent. And the pupil was fixed, mid-dilated, and not reacting to light. The anterior segment findings of the left eye were also normal. In the dilated fundus examination, we saw that the disc was almost atrophic. The macula had the typical cherry red spot and the foveal reflex was absent. The retinal blood vessels were attenuated and the typical cattle truck appearance was visible, and the peripheral fundus was milky white. So all in all, CRAO picture was there. So on investigations, we found out that the blood sugar was consistently above 300 mg per dl, although the patient was not a known case of diabetes mellitus. His blood urea was raised and the WBC counts were raised. So we went for deep nasal KOH swab, and we found out that this was a broad aseptic hyphae. This is a case in the early April days. This was the first case that we found in our hospital of mucormycosis. So the patient was unable to get MRI because, first of all, he needed high flow oxygen. So we could not send him an MRI with oxygen cylinder. Also, he was unable to stay without oxygen for long. So we got the CT done, and we saw that there was a paranasal, there was mucosal thickening in the paranasal sinuses, and especially the right ethmoidal sinus mucus thickening could be appreciating, which was encroaching the lamina papyracea. Also, if you see the orange arrow,
it is above the medial rectus, then we can see a little thickening, which our radio fellow said that it may be invasion of the tissue or swelling. So we were not clear at that time. So we made the diagnosis that this was right-sided rhinovirus leukomycosis. So first thing that we did was we strictly tried to get his blood sugar under control. We started intravenous liposomal amphotericin B 500 ml of dextrose, 5% over 4 hours. Now, first we used to hydrate the patient, give Avil, and then we used to start this. Then we had planned the patient for sinus debridement and right eye transcutaneous retrobulbar injection amphotericin B, acetol 3.5 mg per ml. But before we can do all this, unfortunately, we lost the patient to cardiopulmonary arrest, which was secondary to COVID-19 pneumonitis. My case too is that of a 55-year-old female who was a housewife in Indore. She also had similar complaints of swelling and pain in right eye since 4 days and left eye since 2 days. There was loss of vision in right eye since 3 days, drooping of right eye upper lid since 3 days, and left eye since 2 days. And there was diminution of vision in left eye since 1 day. So this patient was apparently all right 14 days back. She had come positive for COVID, but she was being managed at home. It was only that when her eyes started to show symptoms, she came to us and she got admitted in the COVID ward as she was still positive. And her CT severity score was 17 by 25. All these symptoms were in onset and they had suddenly started to show an act, and therefore they came to our hospital. Now we came to know that the patient was a known case of hypertension and chronic kidney disease since 3 years. She was also a known case of hypothyroidism, and she was taking thyroxine 75 microgram. And there was no history of diabetes mellitus and no history of vaccination. She was herself taking multiple broad spectrum antibiotics and steroids like Medrol 4mg. Now this is the clinical picture of our patient. So on day one, we had only seen the right eye involvement, but till day three, we could see that both the eyes got involved. So it was very rapid. On examination, we understood that the right eye had real negative extraocular movements. The right eye was restricted in all the directions. The lids were swollen, lashes matted, conjunctiva showed chemosis, and the pupil was again fixed, mid-dilated and not reacting to light. The left eye also had a vision more than 3 feet finger count, but the extraocular movements were restricted in all the medial sides, and there was slight abduction present. The lids were swollen, lashes again matted. There was ptosis which was starting and progressing in front of us. And the pupil was reacting, but sluggishly reacting. The fundus right eye again had a CRAO picture. In investigations, we found out that the blood urea was as raised as 888. The normal value should be less than 40, but we had more than 888. The serum creatinine was over the roof again. And the deep nasal cavity swab showed that broad aseptic hyphae was. We could get the MRI done in this patient, and we saw that in the right eye, as you can see, there is mild proptosis, and retrobulbar tissue infiltration is very much appreciable. Also, the radiologist said that there is posterior tenting, which is leading to the distorted contour of the eyeball, which may suggest that there might be a retrobulbar abscess. Then you can see that these are the sinuses, ethmoid sinus and the maxillary sinus. There was mucosal thickening, especially on the right side. The sphenoid sinus also showed mucosal thickening more on the right side. The MRI report in the brain also showed that there were multiple infarcts, but we could not make out if those were because of the thromboembolic episodes of the COVID infection itself or due to mucus. But we concluded this was rhinovital cerebral mucormycosis. Because the patient's kidney condition was not fine, we had to start her on posaconazole IV 300 mg BD. We gave it on day one, and from day two started posaconazole 300 mg OD. We started her on dialysis, and we suggested that she should get right-sided sinus debridement and right-side transcutaneous retrobulbar amphotericin B injection as early as possible. But the patient refused, and unfortunately she went for leave against medical advice, and she certified 5 days afterwards. The problem that we have been facing in our college is that we have been treating a lot of COVID patients, and all the patients that we are seeing are mostly COVID positive.
senior faculties, there is a very big dilemma that we have been facing. There is no availability of liposomal amphotericin B. It is very costly. Also, our OTs cannot be opened completely because of the infection that is COVID. We have been unable to operate mostly because most of the patients themselves back out that we are already facing a crisis that is COVID. And how can we go for something like this now? How can we go for a surgery when we are already facing this? Most of the patients that we see already have their family members who are positive. So it's very difficult for us to convince them. And even if we are able to convince them, the lack of sources always stop us from the treatment. So this is what we have been facing. Although we have been seeing the cases, although we know maybe what, we have a slight idea of what is to be done, but we have only been able to do medical management.
Unfortunately, both the cases were having systemic condition was not good in both the cases. And yes. In that case also, I don't think if you want to do something, you will not get the fitness from the anesthesia side or medical side. Yes. So you can't do in such cases. Bhagesh, you want to say something?
Yeah, the scenario in which the people are working, they are limiting themselves, limiting them for doing from doing the with the things which are indicated, and even if their patients are receiving oral posaconazole, but that is not enough. IV amphotericin B is a must for every patient who is having sinus orbital disease, and as we seen all the three cases. That at least the case which was having tinting of the eyeball, we have to post that case for excentration surgery, and but that was not possible in that setup. So it is quite worse thing that we cannot we are having a lot many things to do, but we cannot do those things. It is really a difficult situation for a clinician. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Manushri, can I add one point here?
Yes, Manushri.
So, nice presentation, Dr. Akshita. Can you show the last case MRI scan?
Which slide?
Yes, this one. Here you can see the tinting of the globe. So, and the tinting of the globe happens when there is a increase in the intraconal pressure. So that is one thing. And the other thing is here you can see almost a homogeneous density of the tissue. So if there is an abscess here, then it should show some multiloculated areas or something black areas with the margin of the white hyperintense shadow. So that is the sign of abscess. So I don't think so in this case, there is an abscess. There is definite increase in the orbital inflammation due to the fungal reaction.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Shweta. So we have some more questions which would like to ask the panel, which are coming from our YouTube viewers. So the viewers want to know that how can we manage a case of endophthalmitis in mucormycosis? That is mucor endophthalmitis.
Fungal. The fungal.
Let Arun answer this question.
Till now, there's only one publication, one single case report about mucor-related endoph or an intraocular invasion. We've seen a couple of aspergillus, actually. We've seen a couple of subretinal abscess with aspergillus that we had operated, and but no mucor. So no mucor has been reported. But yes, there's only one single case report.
What are the things with the literature regarding mucormycosis? I have been gone through the literature from radiological, dentistry, and maxillofacial, and ENT literature also. So all these those literature, what they have, even in the microbiology also, it has been given that the mucor is having tendency to spread from sinuses to orbit, and the orbital soft tissue is a tissue that is favorite for the fungus like mucor. Mucor is a filamentous fungus with a non-septate hyphae having right angle branching, and which is different from the Aspergillus. Aspergillus can have intraocular spread to travel through the blood, but the mucor is having a contagious spread, that is from the sinus it travels through the along with the nerves from the inferior orbital fissure that comes to orbit. So it is very certain that the cases of endophthalmitis with having mucor inside are less.
That's exactly Rajesh. There's only one case report in which suggest mucor related endoph. Otherwise, there's no case report.
Probably it is the more of a panophthalmitis kind of a picture, which mucor is presenting with, rather than vitreous exudates. It is just the scleral involvement which is giving that kind of a picture. So probably it's more of dealing with panophthalmitis with mucor than endophthalmitis.
So we are less likely to, so the diagnosis of this should be less likely. That we should keep it lower in the list.
Very low.
Okay, we would now like to move on to the next speaker, Dr. Swati Jain, who would be presenting her case series. Dr. Swati is from Rajasthan. So we have a speaker who will be discussing about some cases from the other state as well. Dr. Swati, please.
Yes, we have. Yes, we have. I will share the slide. Is my case is visible on the screen? Excuse me?
No, your screen is not there. Your video is shared. The screen share is not there. You have to share the screen.
Is it visible, ma'am, now?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
First, I would like to thank all the IDOS members and the seniors, respectable members, to allow me to present my case on this auspicious platform. I am from, in behalf of American International Institute of Medical Sciences, that is a medical college, and GBH American Hospital. I would like to present a case of 56-year-old male which presented to us from another district. He got COVID positive, and after that he got ocular symptoms like face swelling, right-sided face pain, eye redness, and he was presented on 18th of May to our OPD. On details history, we found out that patient was already 10 days before and he had developed fever and cough, the signs of COVID, and came out to be COVID positive. He was on 92% oxygen saturation, so 2 liter oxygen support was needed. So he got injectable steroid also for 3 days in high doses. After that, subsidence of fever, sore throat, and the systemic treatment was there, and he got discharged after 6 days of admission. But he was a type 2 diabetes mellitus patient, and he has deranged blood sugar during the last date of his admission at district hospital Chittorgarh. But after 2 days of discharge from district hospital, he developed the ocular symptoms. So the district hospital person advised the MRI orbit and brain on 17th of May. On MRI, there was a doubt of rhino-orbital mucormycosis, so patient was shifted to our tertiary care center. So on 18th of May, patient presented in our OPD And he was not a clear-cut case for an ophthalmology person, because I have seen so much of cases who are for the clear-cut decision-making. So I just want to discuss what management I have done and my team was done was correct or not. So that is why I am here with you people. His vision was very good, 6'9 in both eyes. Extraocular movements in right eye only restricted in down gaze and slight restricted in the abduction. So slight esotropia was there. Right eye conjunctival congestion was present. There was no chemosis at that time. His intraocular pressure was slight high, 21 millimeter edge. GP flare reaction was absolutely normal. And fundus was also absolutely normal. So we have consulted with our team, which is having ENT surgeon as well as our nephrologist, diabetes control ke liye, endocrinologist and a physician and an anesthetist. So we have advised basic pre-anesthetic pre-op investigation, and patient came out still COVID positive on RT-PCR test. His RBS was 320 milligram per cent. So we have to wait till that time, because we don't have the liposomal amphotericin B. We only had some vials of aqueous based amphotericin B. So we have preferred the intravenous method rather than, I don't have any amphotericin B for retrobulbar use. So we have started adjuvant posaconazole oral therapy, broadest antibiotic topical as well as oral antifungal eye drops. I have advised vodiconazole because there was no amphotericin B, so it was my personal decision that I should give some antifungal with antibacterial or antibiotic therapy. Insulin infusion was given to control the blood sugar, and on the waiting, finally on the 23rd of May, patient came to be negative. So this is the MRI scan, though it is not very clear because it was in the Chittorgarh district and we only found the clips and videos of the patient's MRI. So here we can see mainly the maxillary sinus involvement. There was not much ethmoidal sinus involvement at that time, and only inferior rectus muscle was bulky and edematous. There was no fat changes at that time on the MRI. So we have in the very good scene. In the view of an ophthalmologist, I was reluctant to preserve the eye and preserve the vision. But after 23 days, when we have done repeat CT PNS, because patient was not able to pay for repeat MRI, so we have done the same day CT PNS. So ethmoidal sinus was involved so badly. Though there was no breach in the lamina preparatia, and apart from the inferior rectus muscle, there is lateral rectus muscle involvement is also there, and fat stranding was also noted. So we have planned as a team with the consult of neurosurgeon, nephrologist, our ENT surgeon and anesthetist. We took the patient in OT on the same day of the CT. Sinus debridement surgery was planned, but the sinus involvement of his ethmoid is so much of expensive that no endoscopic surgery decision was there. ENT surgeon was decided to do open debridement for the ethmoidal sinus as well as maxillary sinus. And I, as a part of ophthalmology, I have done the subperiosteal abscess drainage with the temporal root. And on that time, I have found that some part of inferior rectus and lower part of the lid is having some necrose tissue. So I had debrided that necrose tissue at the same sitting. I had not done the lateral orbitotomy, and we have sent our sample for QH and histopathological investigation. So at the same sitting, because of availability of lipophilized amphotericin B, I have given retrobulbar injection on the same day of the sinus surgery. So this is the post op picture of the patient on the day one. So he got good vision of 6/18, and he is having good extraocular movement of right eye. Only restriction in the inferior gaze and in the temporal gaze. He is having slight esotropia at that time. On KOH, peritoneal abscess, there was non-septic HIFC, which are especially seen for mucus. And there is on the Seguron text to Zagar, we have found significant growth on the day 4. But on the first changing of the dressing on 26th of May with ENT surgeon in the OT, we have found some discharge over the orbital area. And till then, 3 days, 25th, and evening of the 25th, there was no discharge. On the morning of the 26th, there was profuse discharge in the eye. So I have repeated retrovalvar amputation B injection on the 26th of 2021, and after that went on 28th of 2021. As we can see, when these are my clear cut cases, when there was indication of excentration, we have done excentration lidless sparing surgery, and the results are very good. No mortality amongst these people. But in my case, I want to know that my patient was positive and he was having only minimal of maxillary sinus involvement and only one muscle involvement. Because of not availability of the amputation B, what should be the protocol to treat a positive patient with surgery? But there should be some national level guidelines to take a patient at the age of at the stage of positive for COVID, because we are delaying the treatment, we are progressing the stage. After that, we want to save the eye. Some ENT surgeon are forcing that you should do excentration because there is necros tissue, so it will go in the mortality. But we, as an ophthalmologist, we should save the sight. So my question is that he should we save the seeing eye or sacrifice it to remove the fungus completely from the orbit? Please, sir. Please, Pore sir, kindly. I am just here to discuss my case, and this I want to plan. If another case like that is coming to me, what should be my action of planning?
If the clinical findings,
yes,
and can you please mute your mic? Yeah, thank you. If the clinical findings of the orbit are depicting that the tissue is non-viable, and if we are getting some MRI clues like non-contrast enhancement of the extraocular muscle and extensive proptosis, or like in that one photograph that was showing tinting of the globe, even on the CT scan, and if we are getting some loculi of pus, that is abscess cavities inside the orbit, those are the clear-cut indication that we should get rid of that orbit. To remove the excentration, we can achieve two important things. One, we will have a lesser load of the disease in that patient. And secondly, after removing the dead and necrotic part, we are having a direct approach to the vascular area which is lying behind for the amputation B to reach. So these are the two principles for which we used to go for excentration surgery. And in your case, if the patient is having such a clinical signs and MRI features who are supporting the decision of excentration, then we must go for it.
But sir, if there is good vision, we should try to preserve the vision always.
One should always give a try to preserve the vision. One should always give a try to preserve the eyeball. Up to which extent? Up to that extent that we should not get any signs of necrosis of whole of the orbit. Even in some cases, I am now, from my side, I am getting localized involvement of necrosis inside the orbit. So I am, in those cases, I am going forward for orbitotomy surgery and taking out that necrotic area only, and cleaning the cavity with the amputation B of 1 milligram per ml dose. So it is better, always better to save the organ. And if it is non-viable, and if we want better perfusion of the antifungal medication, we must go for excentration surgery.
Another question is, sir, that if there is any muscular swelling and bulk, only this is the presentation on the MRI, is there necessary to use retrovalvar amputation B in each and every patient along with injectable IV amputation B? Is it necessary to use?
I am not at all in the favor of using amputation B in a retrovalvar area, but if we are on the observation stage of the patient, patient is already has undergone a debridement surgery and patient is already on IV amphotericin, and we are as an ophthalmic surgeon, we are just observing the case. So meanwhile, we can plan intratrabecular amphotericin.
Same question. One of my patient, she got only orbital involvement. Maybe the infection came from the ophthalmic artery. So only globe was involved. On the MRI, there was clear cut clearance of the muscles and periorbital spaces. There is no communication with any sinus. But on the eye examination, I was no PL, and he was exudative RD was there, and along with that, there was only some part of retina. I can see clearly that it is having a subretinal exudate, like fungus, chalky white exudates. So in that case, sir, enucleation, is it an option apart from excentration?
Enucleation was never been an option for fungal infection is concerned. If we are if you are getting infection inside on the retina or in the vitreous cavity, then we must get some infection in the intraconal space also. And in that case also, we used to preserve the globe by giving intravenous antifungal agents. And if the patient endophthalmitis is worsening or patient is getting hypotonous eyeball, then we must proceed for the excentration.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. We are running out of time. So we have a video presentation, a couple of video presentations. I would like to invite Dr. Bhagyesh Pore, sir, to proceed on to his video first. Sir, you are somehow muted. I have asked to unmute
you,
please.
Yeah. In the last 1.5 months, I'm seeing a lot of cases of orbital mucormycosis, and many of the ophthalmic surgeons from Indore and outside Indore, they are also getting the cases on the for a daily basis in their OPD. And many of them patients are requiring, they require the many of patients to post for the excentration surgery. Many of the surgeons are not aware of how to do exactly the excentration procedure. So first of all, excentration surgery is defined as it is a destructive surgery with a removal of all the contents of orbit. Lids being not considered as a content of orbit, they are considered to be the part of face. So that may or may not be sacrificed during excentration. All the cases of orbital mucormycosis which we are seeing are we are doing our lid sparing excentration, but in some cases we have already gangrenous lids in the advanced orbital disease, and only those cases we are sacrificing the lids. So to go with the step by step approach, I did the responsibility of shooting the excentration surgery step by step was done by my wife Dr. Rohini. And she has created the video for the demonstration purpose. So let's go through the video. Not all the steps have been demonstrated in this video, but as many steps which are important for the surgeon's point of view, that has been demonstrated. So please let me know if the video is running fluently or.
It's not running now, sir. We can't see the video.
I already started the video.
Maybe someone from the technical team can assist you.
So actually, it is playing in another window, right? And you will have to stop screen share and share the video window. Okay. Or else share your desktop. Then everything that you do on the desktop will be visible.
Okay. That
way. And when you share, please, there'll be a small box which will say share sound. Please tick that so that you can hear the video sound.
Okay. I have clicked the share sound. Now my screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Yes, we can view the file.
Yes, sir.
I have opened the video.
No, video is still not visible. Can you pause the video? Stop screen share for now.
Yeah, I have paused the video, stop the share.
Yeah, now when you click on screen share, you will see a VLC media window also in that pop-up box.
Okay, yeah.
Select the VLC window.
Sure. Now is it visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible, yes.
Now you can start playing.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Most welcome.
Is it playing fluently or with the interruption?
The bit of lag, video has been played. It's playing properly.
The subsidiary insulin has been given. Upper lid is being retracted and now I am dissecting levator muscle. Usually we require at least two assistants for this surgery. The pre-aponeurotic fat we can see protruding out. We don't have to disturb the fat. Now we are on the lateral wall of the orbit and incising on the periosteum. Now we are on the superior rim and inside the periosteum. Apparently I have opened the superorbital artery and vein. After cauterizing that, I am inciting the superior orbital vein periosteum. All the dissection is being done with the radio frequency or the coagulating cautery. The superior orbital notch is being cauterized. The superior oblique tendon, the pulley of the superior oblique being released. We are going to the inferior orbit, the incising the periosteum on the inferior side. Now I am disinserting the inferior oblique muscle origin. We are on the inferior medial side. Coming to the medial side, I am now disinserting the lacrimal sac from the needle lacrimator. We are on the floor of the orbit and we have entered the orbital orbit and dissecting the periorbital from the floor. This is all the blunt dissection is going on. Periorbita is elevated from all the wall from the orbit so that we can reach up to the apex of the orbit. We have cleared all the periorbita and now we are going to the apex and releasing the orbital tissue from orbital apex, that is inferior orbital feature, superior orbital feature and optic canal. And thus we have been, the orbital tissue are out, the residual orbital tissue are being removed. This is the post-operative appearance, this is the pre-op and this is the post-operative appearance. Today only this patient completed 15 days. And have a very good second reconstruction of the orbital cavity also. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Seeing that excentration was was really it's quite an extensive surgery. Being a retina surgeon, you are used to opening up the conjunctiva and everything, but really seeing the contents of the orbit is like there's so much in there. The orbit is really a Pandora's box. Thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing that video, sir. It was an excellent video.
Thank you.
Any comments from the panel?
Excellent video and love the background music also.
Thank you.
So, Bhagesh, one question. Do you give amputation the wash after the excentration, after you've removed the orbital contents? Do you give
No. Not at all. If If I have only under two cases, I have done extended enucleation, that is enucleation with removal of anterior 1/3 or anterior 2/3 of the orbital tissues. In those cases, in the remaining 1/3 tissue, I have given injectable amphotericin, that is 1 mg per ml doses. But as far as the...
I just meant by once you remove the
orbit. Cleaning of the... Yeah, after cleaning of the... Removing of the orbit, the amphotericin wash is not at all mandatory because many ENT surgeons are doing medial orbital decompression also.
Hmm.
So we are already open with the sinus cavity while doing ENT.
But
so
why not do it direct way? The ENT surgeons are doing it on the medial this thing. I meant before your closure, before you're doing the lid closure, before you're taking the skin sutures, why not give an amphotericin wash at that moment?
Yeah, I didn't find out any role of that. Instead, I do the wash of the orbital cavity with antiseptic solution iodine rather than giving the wash with the amphotericin B.
Exactly. My point is, why not do this with the amphotericin B?
As far as literature review is concerned, I have not seen any doing amphotericin wash for the bare orbit. It is done in the procedures where we are removing the part of orbit and maintaining the tissue, residual tissue behind. Only in those cases, I feel it is important to do the amphotericin wash.
Great. Nice video, Bhagesh.
Nice video, Dr. Bhagesh. So I would agree with Dr. Arun. As we know that mucormycosis not only involves the soft tissues, it involves bones as well. So in my experience, I always wash, I give an amphotericin wash all after the excentration. And also I keep an amphotericin soaked gauze inside. With maybe if it is, if the sinuses are open, I can hang there and remove from the nose side. Or I can leave a small wound here. From there, I can just take it out on the day two of the surgery. So it will make sure that anything left or any orbital invasion or anything, we can the amphotericin can take care later.
Nagas, do you send these samples for histopath of the apex?
Yeah, I am routinely sending both the samples, that is removal of orbital tissue. And when I'm doing removal of apex tissue also, the both samples I took is taken in the different sample bottles and they both
I... With your vast experience, did you find any other organism apart from mucor?
Only Aspergillus, not any other organism.
So we also...
Currently we are dealing with opportunistic infections.
Yes.
And as far as opportunistic infections are concerned, only mucor is the main culprit. Aspergillus, yeah, it is getting found in a mixed way in some cases, but the mucor is the predominant fungal infection which we are getting.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And one point I want to add, the histopathologists are doing such an excellent job. Some histopathologists, I have sent my sample almost 10 of the histopathologists in the different hospitals. And all the histopathologists are giving and doing such a wonderful job. They are mentioning presence of the fungal hyphae in all the orbital tissue that separately. That is, they are testing extraocular muscles also. They are testing optic nerve also. They are testing globe, sclera, fat, and all the things they are in the orbit. They are mentioning that we are getting fungal growth or fungal hyphae inside this orbital tissue.
Great.
Thank you. We are already beyond our time. So either everyone here has had a very early dinner or will have a very late dinner. But we have one very interesting video from Dr. Shweta Walia, ma'am. I would like to invite ma'am to please present her video.
The purpose of showing this video is that if I am able to do excentration, then each and every ophthalmologist can do it. Starting with the lid markings, after that we pass 3 lid traction sutures. After that, using surgical cautery, over the incision marks, we go in to dissect the tissues. We go beneath the orbicularis in the preseptal plane so that we don't rupture the, we don't have fat entry. We go on dissecting till the orbital roof is reached. We don't have access to radio frequency cautery. We are using simple surgical cautery that is available in every surgical setup. Now dissecting the lower half. Once we reach up to the floor or the orbital wall, we give incision in the periosteum. After incising the periosteum in all the around, this is we are incising the periosteum. We do blunt dissection with the periosteum elevator or lacrimal sac dissector to lift the periorbiter. Now this is incising the periosteum. After that, we'll pass the blunt dissector or a periosteum elevator to elevate the periorbiter. Once that is done, with an enucleation scissor, we can lift the entire of the orbital contents. Though we think that it is since there is necrotic tissue, it will be a bloodless surgery, but there is a lot of bleeding that scares us. And mainly from the superomedial bundle, neovascular bundle. And once the entire orbital contents are out, the remaining orbital tissue has also to be removed. And now you can see the entire of the orbit is clean. There is fresh ooze from the orbital apex. I didn't got much time to edit it and make it fancy, but just to let you all know that if I can do, all of you can do it. And all of you must, for when it becomes a life-saving procedure, we all must intervene. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. That was an excellent video and didn't need any fancy stuff to spruce it up. Everything was very clear. And I think everyone here now must feel that they can approach a case for excentration.
I just wanted to add one thing, Sumit.
Yes, sir, please.
See, the excentration surgery is not very much difficult. The thing is, if the complication occurs, like if you expose the dura, then how you manage? If you have so much of bleeding, how you manage? Yeah. That is an important thing. Obviously, anyone can do, but they should know the complication chances also, as well as how to manage the complications. And even after that, even we are doing excentration quite commonly nowadays, but still the post-operative period is very important.
Yes.
The post-operative follow-up, post-operative, if you have a sinus or if you have anything else, then how you will proceed. Further, he may need the skin grafting or maybe sometimes fat grafting or somewhat for the rehabilitation. So it's not about the procedure you've done that I told you in my presentation also. It is not the procedure like we did the cataract. We did and okay, next day is okay. It's okay. It's not like that. We have to keep follow-up, close follow-up. And obviously the patient, the rehabilitation process would take around 2 to 3 months at least. So that is a whole 2 or 3 months the patient you have to take in care of.
Right. Thank you, sir. Thank you. With this, I would like to just mention one thing, that there are a lot of questions on a YouTube handle. So due to lack of time, we won't be able to take them now, but we will consult our experts and definitely leave a reply. So everyone who's had a question there can definitely check that out. So you will get a reply to that question. With this, I would like to invite our secretary, Dr. Shweta Valiya, ma'am, to present the vote of thanks. Ma'am, over to you.
Dr. Meeta, please do the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Shweta. And I'd like to inform everyone that we have an audience of at least 120 people, members of IDOS, who are watching this across all platforms. And it is honestly a very good audience for a Saturday evening, though we miss the meetings which we used to have, Saturday night dinners and cocktails. But then this is the need of time, and I'm proud of IDOS that we are moving with the times and we are adapting to the situation so beautifully. And I'd like to thank the panelists, Dr. OP sir, Dr. Sharadini ma'am, Dr. Shreya Thakke ma'am, Dr. Bhagesh and Dr. Arun for their contributions to the discussions. This would not have been possible without the speakers who presented their experiences, Dr. Animesh, Dr. Shweta, Dr. Sonam, Dr. Divya, Dr. Akshita and Dr. Swati Jain for joining all the way from Rajasthan. I'd like to thank our moderators, Sumit and Manushri. Sumit, the moustache is looking nice.
Thank you.
And Manushri, very well done job. And
yes.
But not the least, I'd like to thank our sponsors, Ajanta Pharma, Mr. Manoj, Mr. Sanjay Kumar, Omkar, for all the wonderful audio and presentation coordination which you have done. So thank you, everybody. Stay safe. And I know like the times are changing, but we still have to adopt and learn. And together with discussions like this and setting up guidelines, we'll be able to overcome all the challenges which we are facing. Thank you very much.
Good evening, madam, and all the panelists. Just before we, you know, end this session, we would like to thank the entire medical fraternity and the panel of speakers, you know, for a wonderful presentation and your service towards mankind. Our GM Sales and Marketing, Ajanta Prasma, is over here. Mr. Sanjay Srivastav, who would like to extend his you know, words of thanks towards the entire panelists and the other you know, doctors who are watching this particular event. Sanjay sir, over to you, sir.
Yes, good evening, sir and madam. First of all, thank you so much for giving this wonderful opportunity for Ajanta Pharma for sharing this platform and organizing this IDOS webinar. And we are extremely happy to see the wonderful participation by most of you. And it was quite interactive session, which come across more than 2.5 hours approximately. It's a really a great opportunity to be over here. And once again, our heartiest thanks to all the panelists, speakers, and also moderator, which make this program quite successful and meaningful. Sir, I would like to say this Ajanta Pharma always a very, very important health partner with all of you at this tough time pandemic. Here we are having, as you know, Ajanta Pharma known for innovation. We have introduced so many good products as far the portfolio of ophthalmology is concerned. Sir, we are having a Macro Gold, where as per the this contains melatonin, and as per the study confirmed, melatonin plays a very, very important role as a prophylaxis role to take care of even the pandemic COVID-19. Because as you know, pandemic this directly hitting lungs, but as per the research study confirmed, it prevents the lungs fibrosis. So as per the prophylaxis cases, this is also quite effective. Melatonin only available in India through Macro Gold, as you know. And Macro Gold, a very, very serious senior brand for last 20 years, as already you are aware. So, and recently we have also introduced, Madam, Maximize Ultra, which is a very strong brand as per the excellent lubrication of this sodium hyaluronate with 3% with 4 hours, more than 4 hour retention time also. So once again, we are extremely thankful to all of you for giving this wonderful opportunity to Ajanta Pharma. We request to all of you, because you are very, very important in this tough time, you are taking care of all the patients. Because what we experienced, madam and sir, many time physician, they can take away from as far as the patient is concerned, but you cannot avoid that as far as the distance is concerned. So our sincere appeal to all of you, please take utmost precaution and safety. Thank you so much for giving this opportunity once again.
Thank you once again, all the entire team of panel of the speakers and the panelists out here. We once again thanks you for your valuable time and the wonderful presentation that you all have made. Thank you once again for the opportunity and the management. Thank you. Stay safe, stay protected, sir. Thank you, sir. Good night.
Good.